Hi, let's talk about the pharyngeal plexus. In this video, we'll discuss the contributions and neuromodalities of the glossopharyngeal nerves, the vagus nerves, and the cervical sympathetic trunks to the pharyngeal plexus. Our story is going to begin at the jugular foramen, through which several very key anatomical features that we'll discuss today are transported out of the skull. The jugular foramen is a window between the occipital bone and the temporal bone through which the internal jugular vein, for which the foramen is named, cranial nerve 9, the glossopharyngeal nerve, cranial nerve 10, the vagus nerve, and cranial nerve 11, the accessory nerve, are all transmitted out of the neurocranium. Just anterior to the jugular foramen, there is an opening in the temporal bone called the carotid canal. And that's the passageway that the internal carotid artery enters into the cranial vault. Now, I mention this because all of these features taken together are going to be surrounded by condensations of deep cervical connective tissue, or fascia, that comprise something called the carotid sheath. And this carotid sheath is going to bundle these elements together as they are transmitted through the neck. So the major constituents within the carotid sheath include the carotid arteries, common, internal, external, and their various branches, the internal jugular vein, and cranial nerve 10 throughout, and proximally cranial nerves 9 and 11. So let's take a look at the posterior aspect of the pharynx to see how these nerves come into play. So there is our jugular foramina on either side. Here we could see the common carotid artery ascending up. And at this point, it's probably the internal carotid if it's heading towards the skull. And let's take note of two of those nerves that were being transmitted through the jugular foramen, the glossopharyngeal and the vagus. The glossopharyngeal nerve we can see descending down here, and this happens on both sides, and it forms a close association with the stylopharyngeus muscle. And then it dives down deep between the two. The glossopharyngeal nerves are the somatic sensory input for the pharyngeal plexus, or the afferent fibers. The other nerve, the vagus nerve, descending down here, and it does on both sides, it's going to send out a pharyngeal branch. That pharyngeal branch is going to conduct somatic motor fibers, or efferent fibers, to the pharyngeal plexus. So, the glossopharyngeal nerve is the somatic sensory, or afferent, provider to the plexus. The vagus nerves are the somatic motor, or the efferent, provider to the plexus. In addition to this, the vagus nerves are also transmitting some visceral motor fibers. These are parasympathetic fibers to the plexus. As we look adjacent to the carotid sheath, so the cervical sympathetic trunk is typically found a little posteromedial to the sheath, we can see the superior cervical ganglion of the cervical sympathetic trunk. There's the middle and the inferior. That superior cervical ganglion is going to provide postganglionic sympathetic fibers to the plexus. These are going to be vasomotor. So they're going to find their way into the walls of the vasculature that will supply this plexus. Now, when we talk about the targets of the plexus, it's probably good to know that this is going to include both the pharynx as well as the soft palate, which is very anatomically close to the pharynx, as you may recall from sagittal views of these structures. Now, the pharyngeal neural plexus is going to innervate most of the muscles and mucosa of the pharynx. The great exceptions to these include the stylopharyngeus muscle. That stylopharyngeus muscle is not innervated by the pharyngeal plexus. It is innervated solely by the glossopharyngeal nerve. And their close anatomical relationship should demonstrate that to you. Another exception is the nasopharynx. If you can imagine that nasopharynx is going to be deep anteriorly there, the pharyngeal plexus never gets to it. It's innervated by a branch of the maxillary division of the trigeminal nerve, or V2 for short, called the pharyngeal nerve. The pharyngeal neural plexus also is going to innervate most of the muscles and the mucosa of the soft palate. An exception to this is one of the soft palate muscles called the tensor veli palatini, which is innervated by a branch of the mandibular nerve, or V3 for short, called the nerve to the medial pterygoid. Now, when we think of the function of the pharyngeal plexus beyond the obvious, you know, motor with regards to swallowing and sensory for detecting stimulation, for triggering the deglutition reflex, there's also an opportunity for another reflex known as the pharyngeal or the gag reflex. This is a protective reflex that clamps down the pharynx to prevent any foreign bodies that are unexpected from traveling more distally. So how this works is a stimulus touches the mucosa of the pharynx that is transmitted back to the CNS and the brain through the glossopharyngeal nerve. And the brain sends out a response via the vagus nerve, and that response is to clamp down. You know it as a gagging. Now, the literature is pretty sparse on this, but about 1/3 of the population will have a gag reflex, 1/3 will not have a gag reflex, and 1/3 of the population will have a hypergag reflex, which may include emesis or vomiting. So we've discussed the pharyngeal neural plexus, the inputs, and the targets. This is your summary slide. Thank you very much for your time.